This video will demonstrate an upgrade to PI Buffer Subsystem version 4.3 from API Buffer Server. Let's go over some of the system requirements. From the PI Live library, we can see that PI Buffer Subsystem supports both 32-bit and 64-bit client and server Windows operating systems, starting from Windows Server 2003 SP2. Any destination PI Data Archive server is going to need to be version 3.4.375 or later. We always recommend running the latest version for the best performance. Therefore, it may not be appropriate to upgrade to PI Buffer Subsystem if you are buffering PI interfaces that are on non-Windows platforms or are writing data to PI Data Archive versions 3.4.370 or earlier. So please make sure your system meets all of these requirements before proceeding with the upgrade. Finally, if you're configuring buffering for PI API interfaces, you'll need PI ICU version 1.4.15 or later. Configuring buffering for AF SDK or PI SDK clients will require PI AF client 2014 or later, or PI SDK 2014 or later. So let's take a look at what the current configuration of my interface machine is. From PI ICU, we can see that I already have two PI interfaces configured and sending data. The first instance is writing to Carbon, which is the name of my two-member PI Data Archive collective. The second instance is writing to Graphite, which is my standalone independent PI Data Archive server. Let's take a look at the buffering configuration. So within Tools Buffering, we can see that the buffering option is Enable Buffering with API Buffer Server. Additionally, if we go to the Buffered Servers list, we can see that all three of my PI Data Archive servers are buffered. So that includes the two members of my PI Data Archive collective, as well as the independent PI Data Archive server, Graphite. Keep in mind that this is an upgrade, so the services for the PI interfaces will need to be stopped during the upgrade. So it's important that you have the appropriate downtime scheduled, or you have interface failover configured so that the data downtime is minimized during the upgrade. Okay, so the install kit for PI Buffer Subsystem can be found from the OSIsoft TechSupport page at techsupport.osisoft.com. Once your browser's there, you can go to the Downloads page. And at the Downloads page, you can type in PI Buffer Subsystem for the product name and click Search. So in this case, we're going to be configuring buffering for PI API interfaces. So we'll be downloading the PI Interface Configuration Utility Install Kit version 1.4.16.79a. Alright, so I already have the install kit downloaded. Let's go ahead and get started with the upgrade. Okay, my install kit is saved in my D drive install kits folder. So once I'm there, I'm going to right-click the install kit and run as administrator. It will then ask me for a location to extract the installation files, so I'm just going to put it into that same install kits folder. The installation splash screen shows me that PI Buffer Subsystem is one of the modules that will be upgraded. You'll notice that the installation actually prompts you and shows you which services will need to be stopped for the upgrade. So you'll notice here that both of my PI interface services are listed here. So once again, please make sure before proceeding with the upgrade that you have the appropriate downtime scheduled or you have interface failover configured to minimize the data downtime. The final part of the upgrade is this interactive upgrade wizard to help finalize the configuration settings when upgrading from API Buffer Server to PI Buffer Subsystem. So you'll notice that on the first screen, the upgrade wizard actually scans and detects all of the PI interfaces installed on the interface machine. So we can see here that it's detected both of my PI interfaces, the first instance writing to my PI Data Archive collective, and the second instance writing to my independent PI Data Archive server. So I'm going to have both of the checkboxes checked because I want to configure PI Buffer Subsystem for both interface instances. Next, the upgrade wizard does a connection test to make sure that PI Buffer Subsystem can successfully connect and authenticate to each of the PI Data Archive servers. So at the top, we can see that currently the PI Buffer Subsystem service account is running under the local system account. So to follow the security best practices, I'm actually going to change this to run under a custom domain service account. Now notice that this custom domain service account is going to be added to the local administrators group, as this is a necessary requirement for the service account that PI Buffer Subsystem runs under. So we can see that the connection tests are coming back with these security errors, no access secure object. Since we're upgrading from API Buffer Server, it's good to take this opportunity to review the security configuration on the PI Data Archive server, since much of it probably will need to be changed when upgrading from API Buffer Server. So for example, with PI Buffer Subsystem, we can now use mappings, and it is highly recommended that the authentication with PI Data Archive servers is now done through PI mappings. So we're going to go through the configuration for PI mappings here. At the bottom, we can see that there's an option to create the mappings for us. So we're going to choose the option PI mapping, and then when we click browse, it's going to open up a list of all the PI identities on the PI Data Archive server. So in this case, I already have this PI interfaces buffers identity created, so I'm going to use this as my identity for the PI mapping. So once that's selected, all I have to do is click create. That will create the PI mapping on the PI Data Archive server for the Carbon Collective. So I'll want to do the same thing for the Graphite PI Data Archive server. So I'm going to click Browse and choose the PI identity I want configured for the PI mapping and click Create. So once that's done, I can open up PI SMT and check that all the rest of my security configuration is correct on the PI Data Archive servers. So once PI SMT is open, I have all three of my PI Data Archive servers selected, and I'm going to go to Security and use the Mappings and Trust plugin. On the Mappings tab, we can see that the PI mapping was successfully created on all three of my PI Data Archive servers. Additionally, the PI identity is the same as what we specified, which is the PI interfaces buffers identity. Okay, so what other security configurations are needed for this PI identity? What we'll want to check is, first of all, at the database security level for the PI point table, we need to make sure that that PI identity has read access. So this is covered in this case because I have PI world given read access. So if you don't have PI World listed here, you want to make sure the PI identity for your PI Buffer subsystem is listed to have read access at the PI point database security level. Additionally, we want to make sure that the security configuration is correct on all of the individual points. So I'm going to open up the Point Builder plugin and select one of my PI interface points to show you what that looks like. So within the security tab of the PI point, what we want to make sure is that the PI identity that PI Buffer Subsystem is under has read access under point security. So once again, this is covered by PI World here. If you don't have PI World, make sure your PI identity for PI Buffer Subsystem is listed here to have read access. Additionally, the PI identity for PI Buffer Subsystem will need to have both read and write permissions within the data security. Alright, so now I've confirmed all of the security configuration for PI Buffer Subsystem on my PI Data Archive server. But I can see that within the upgrade wizard, I still have these security errors where it's saying no access secure object. Unfortunately, this is a known issue with the upgrade wizard that's planned to be fixed in a later version of PI Buffer Subsystem. The issue is that even though I've changed the service account for this custom domain service account, the connection test is still using the local system account. So since I've already confirmed the security configurations on the PI Data Archive servers themselves, I can safely ignore these errors and click Next. The next screen asks where you would like to save the PI Buffer Subsystem buffer queue files. So the recommendation here is to choose the hard disk which has the most available space, but which is also not the hard disk which hosts the operating system. So in this case, I'm going to keep it the same because D drive has the most available space, and it also is not the operating system disk drive. The upgrade wizard then does a final verification, and we can see that everything here is successful. So we can now exit the upgrade wizard. So now that the upgrade is finished, we can see that it has brought back all of the services that were stopped for the upgrade. So my two PI interface services are now started again. However, notice now that PI buffer server is now listed as stopped and disabled. And this is because we've switched from using PI buffer server to PI buffer subsystem. The final screen is the buffering manager report, which shows any errors, warnings, and informational messages from the upgrade wizard. So in this case, I did not have any errors or warnings. However, if you did have any errors or warnings, they would be listed here. And based on the error or warning, you can take the appropriate action. At the bottom, there's this option to launch buffering manager when setup completes. So I'm going to choose to uncheck that box so I can show you later how to access buffering manager if you did have this box unchecked or if you need to access buffering manager later. But you can leave the box checked if you'd like to bring up buffering manager right away. Alright, so now the upgrade is complete, and we can see that PIBuffer subsystem was successfully installed. So the first thing I'll probably want to do is just make sure that I'm still receiving data for the points from my PI interfaces on this machine. So back in SMT, I'm going to use the current values plugin now and do a search for some of the points being written to from the PI interfaces on this machine. Alright, so I have the points selected, and I'm going to choose to update them. And we can see that the PI points on all three of my PI data archive servers are indeed updating with live values. So it looks like the data is good. But how can I tell that this data is actually going through the PI buffer subsystem? So as mentioned earlier, what we can do is use this new GUI tool called Buffering Manager. So if you had the checkbox deselected during the upgrade wizard, you can access Buffering Manager from the PI ICU. Once PI ICU is open, we can go to Tools Buffering. So notice how going to Tools Buffering no longer opens the traditional buffering configuration window, but instead now launches the Buffering Manager. Buffering Manager is a GUI tool that's new to PI Buffer Subsystem version 4.3. It's basically a dashboard that shows the live health statuses of all the PI Data Archive servers configured for buffering. Additionally, it's also the central place to configure all of the settings for PI Buffer Subsystem. Alright, so what can we see? So here on this initial screen is the global level. So the global level shows all the counters for all of the PI Data Archive servers configured for buffering altogether. So we can see at the bottom that I have my two logical servers. So logical meaning basically either an independent PI Data Archive server or a PI Data Archive collective. And we can see that the total events sent globally is about 12,479 events. So this is the total number of events being sent to all three of my PI Data Archive servers. If I wanted to see the events being sent for individual PI Data Archives or PI Data Archive collectives, I can choose which one I want to look at the bottom. So let's say I want to look at the Carbon PI Data Archive collective. So at this level, it shows the counters for the collective. And I can see that for the PI Data Archive collective, I've sent about 10,698 events. And if I wanted to look at the individual members themselves, I can do that by clicking on the member that I'm interested in. And that will show me the event counters just for that PI Data Archive collective member itself. Okay, so let's also confirm that the PI Buffer Subsystem service is running under that custom domain service account that we configured during the upgrade wizard. So within the services applet, under PI Buffer Subsystem, we can see that it is indeed running as that custom domain service account. Okay, so we've confirmed that everything has been upgraded and we're receiving data, and now the upgrade from PI API buffer server is complete. If you would like to configure buffering for more PI API interfaces, please watch the Configure PI Buffer Subsystem for PI API Interfaces video.